today I'm going to be talking about Bell's theorem. Now, I assume that that is something with which all of you are pretty familiar in view of its close connection to the general topic of quantum information. I think the sociological situation regarding Bell's theorem is quite interesting. It has been described in cold print as, quote, the most profound result of science, unquote. And that was without irony, I think. On the other hand, there is a small but non-zero body of physicists who claim that Bell's theorem is either wrong or trivial. Not infrequently, the same people go from claiming that it's wrong to claiming that it's trivial. Because I assume you are aware of this sort of undercurrent of objection to it, let's try to see what exactly it says and what it implies about the world. So, as in the last lecture, we have the standard setup in which we have, it could be an atomic source, it could be a down conversion source, or indeed something different again, but basically a source which sends out two microscopic entities, generally speaking photons, back to back. And the crucial point is that we are going to arrange to take photon number one, say, at this end of the lab, and switch it in what we hope is a random manner into one of two measuring devices, one of which is basically going to ask it the question, are you B or not B? The other of which is going to ask the incompatible question, are you B prime or not B prime? So typically, one question might be, are you polarized vertically or horizontally? The other one might be, are you polarized 45 or 45? And so similarly at this end of the laboratory. And we are going to assume, and this is, I think, it is important to emphasize this because it's something which is not always emphasized in discussions of Bell's theorem, that we are going to assume not just that at the end of the day we collect data, which obviously we do, but that data is actually in some sense realized and set in its final form at a fairly early stage in the whole operation. So typically the sort of assumptions that people usually make without thinking much about it are that a definite outcome is realized when, let us say, the photon has been switched into this counter and that counter has clicked or not clicked. But of course, click or not click here doesn't mean something that you actually hear with the ear. It means that something has been, say, registered in computer memory or something of the kind. So the bare facts, basically, are that the Bell-CHSH theorem tells us that no theory of the objective local class, I'll come back and define that in a few minutes, no theory of the objective local class can give experimental predictions in complete agreement with the predictions of quantum mechanics. And the second piece of raw data is that with a very few exceptions in the very earliest days of the subject, essentially all experimental data seem to be consistent with the predictions of quantum mechanics. And moreover, if you exclude the possible effect of the so-called loopholes, then they're inconsistent, the data appear to be inconsistent with the predictions of the class of objective local theories. So that then raises two obvious questions. First of all, what does the statement one, which I think for most people at least is pretty firm, what does that tell us about the structure of quantum mechanics as such? The second question is, irrespective of the truth or not of quantum mechanics, what does observation two tell us about the structure of the physical world? Now, I think it is important to be clear, those questions are not the same. It could be, and actually personally, I would take a fair bet that it will be, that someday in the future, we are going to eventually realize that the formalism of quantum mechanics in some sense is not basic and does not in fact completely describe the world at all levels. That it's rather, I mean, it's a very good approximate scheme for description of matter at the kind of level which in the year 2011 we're able to investigate it. In other words, it would have the quantum mechanics, would it perhaps have the same kind of relation to, let us say, post-year 2000-3000 theory that classical mechanics does to quantum mechanics itself. If that were to be the case, then basically I think one could say in some sense that all the lengthy discussion in the physics and philosophy literature about the meaning of quantum mechanics would really in some sense have been a waste of time, because after all we'd have learned that it really is nothing but a sort of approximate recipe for getting results which are in some sense not fundamental. Nevertheless, even if that were to happen, presumably the experimental results which we have in the year 2011 are going to stand up, and so they're still going to be there even after quantum mechanics itself fails. So that question B, will actually survive any future demise of quantum mechanics. So I'm going to, in some sense, try to put more emphasis on question B than on question A, but I will try to start off at least by saying something about question A. And to discuss question A, it's rather useful to have a notation which can cope simultaneously with quantum mechanics and with hidden variable models, and perhaps even with something rather more general than that. And there's a rather nice paper by John Jarrett way back in 84 in Naos, reprinted in American Journal of Physics, which does this. I'm not clear how well known this this paper is, in fact, in the general community concerned with Bell's theorem, but my own feeling is that it's rather a good, clear discussion of some of these issues. So let's try to... I've changed Jarrett's notation somewhat, but basically stuck with his main line of argument. Let's define the setting on the right-hand side, that is, the depending on whether a particular photon is actually switched into counter A, there's an A up there which you can't see, counter A or counter A prime, you'll say that the setting on the right-hand side is little a or little a prime, and similarly if B or B prime on the left-hand side. We're going to call the outcome of the measurement of A plus 1 or minus 1, depending on whether transmission counter in station A did or did not click, similarly for B at the other end. And very importantly, we'll introduce a label alpha, which is defined to be the state description of the system. And that's a really rather general concept. It's in some sense the best state description that we can give within the context of whatever theory we're talking about. It could be a hidden variable, lambda, but equally well, if we're talking about quantum mechanics, it could be simply the quantum state. Sorry, because after all, remember that in quantum mechanics, that's the state vector is the only, is the most complete description you're allowed to give. So now let's consider three possible propositions. The first is that with settings little a and little b, the probability of getting outcomes a and b are simply given by taking the possible state descriptions, working out the probability of getting a and b for that particular state, and integrating over the possible states which may occur with an appropriate weighting factor. That seems a rather generic statement, and we'll just come back to that in a few minutes. Now there are a couple of more, somewhat more specific assumptions one might or might not want to make. The second assumption is that the probability of finding a particular possible state, alpha, of the system is independent of the settings. Again, we'll see in a moment what the actual implementation of that is with regard to the experimental setup. And finally, we have the condition of strong locality. When I have, and very important to stress this, when I have a particular state alpha, then in that state, the probability of getting results A and B for settings little a and little b is a product of probabilities referring to the two stations separately. It turns out that if you make these three assumptions, then these are sufficient to establish the CHSH inequality, and with the additional assumption of perfect anticorrelation, they then suffice to establish the original Bell inequality. I'll concentrate, however, mostly on the CHSH inequality. And this proof, I mean, there are any number of proofs in the literature, of course. This particular proof that I've written down here is just taken in a slightly adapted form from Shimoni's discussion in the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy. Incidentally, this is one case, I think, where you can actually trust Wikipedia, because if you look up Bell's theorem in Wikipedia, you'll find that the article there on Bell's theorem is precisely this article by Shimoni from the Stanford Encyclopedia, and I think it's fairly good. Let's define this quantity A bar of alpha, which is the expectation value of the quantity A in the state alpha, and it's given by this quantity here. Now, according to assumption 3, you can split this up in this way. This quantity here is just has to be 1, since the sum of probabilities of getting all possible results has to sum to 1. So that's equal to that. And since the sum of probabilities of getting possible results of odd A is 1, then that says that the expectation value of A, rather trivially, in any particular state alpha has to be between minus 1 and 1. Now, for any four real quantities, QR, Q prime, QR, Q prime, R prime, lying between minus 1 and plus 1 is a very trivial geometrical statement that simply says that this particular combination must be less than or equal to 2. So if I take the averages over the same state, that must be less than or equal to 2. Now, from conditions 1 and conditions 2, the experimental value of this is given by the sum of this quantity here. That has to be the integral of d alpha. In general, of course, remember, p would, in the most general theory, p would actually be a function of the settings of a and b. That is, which state occurs might be a function of how you chose the setting or how you did the switching. But we've assumed that's not going to be the case by assumption 2. So then we now have this result here. By assumption 3, you can break up this probability here again, like so. So this is just given by this expression here, and now, of course, we're home, because we've already proved that this is true, and now we simply integrate that over alpha and get this result, CHSH inequality. Any questions or comments on that? I think it's hopefully a pretty standard kind of proof. It's not the only possible kind of proof, and we'll come back to that in a moment or two. Okay. Good. Okay, so now following Jarrett's discussion, quantum mechanics is in fact predicted to violate the CHSH theorem. So it has to apparently violate at least one of these three postulates. Which of them does it violate? First, first condition simply says that the total probability for settings little a and little b of getting outcomes capital A and capital B is just given by basically taking the probability in each state which could occur and integrating over the possible states. Well, I think it's fairly obvious that's trivially fulfilled for a quantum mechanical pure state, because in that case we only have one state occurring, namely the state psi. It's slightly less trivially fulfilled for a mixture. However, it is fulfilled. So that's not what's gone wrong. Setting number two, condition number two was the setting independence of the state. That is, that the probability of a given state occurring for given settings of the, or given switching of the two photons or whatever, is independent of which way they were switched. Now, that is fulfilled by the standard textbook quantum mechanics, in the sense that the density matrix, rho, depends only on the source and perhaps conceivably on events in the past light cone of the emission event, but it's certainly independent of the switching events, which are in some sense still in the future. So, however, we should be rather careful at this point. Like almost all discussions of the EPR-Bell setup do implicitly assume the standard textbook predictive quantum mechanics. If we're not going to do that, if we're going to seriously consider the possibility or that, as it were, the state is post-conditioned, then we are going to be in trouble with that assumption. Again, that's something I'll come back to hopefully later. Finally, the condition of strong locality. That is, the probability of getting, once I've chosen a particular state, the probability of getting, for settings little a and little b, results capital A and capital B, can be broken up into these this product here. In other words, this probability depends only on the probability at the left-hand end of measuring A with setting little a, and multiplied by the probability at the other end of measuring capital B when the setting is little b. That's the condition which Jarrett calls strong locality. I'm not sure if that's by now a standard name or not. What is the situation in quantum mechanics? In quantum mechanics, the alpha is simply the quantum mechanical state, if you're talking about a pure state. So that statement is simply equivalent to a statement about the observed outcome frequencies. For example, it would say the probability of getting clicks in both your counters is simply the product of, when they're set at A and B, is simply the product of getting a clicking counter A when it's set at little a, and getting a clicking counter B set at little b. And that clearly is wrong. That's not what quantum mechanics tells you. For example, with the singlet state, with B is minus A, then if we just, here I switch for a moment slightly inconsistently to the language of spin a half rather than photons, but that's okay. In the singlet state, if I look at either the probabilities individually, I just get a half, but on the other hand, the probability of getting yes, yes, or no, no, is also a half, not a quarter, is not the product, a quarter. So clearly, quantum mechanics is violating that. The conclusion is drawn then. The reason that the predictions of quantum mechanics violate CHSH is that the theory violates strong locality. Okay. So far, hopefully, not too much of a problem. Let's now try to define two further properties. Again, we can be talking about a general system, not necessarily one described by quantum mechanics. There's the so-called, what is by now standardly called the non-signaling property. Jarrett originally called it remote context independence, namely that the probability of getting little a, when you your setting is little a and you're in state alpha, then the probability of getting the result capital A is just the sum over the possible results of getting A and B summed over B. That's the standard non-signaling condition. If that were not fulfilled, then you could use the situation to transmit information superluminally. The second property is remote outcome independence or predictive completeness, and the statement given by, I think this is a quote from Shimoni actually, not Jarrett, that a state is predictively complete with respect to a measurement M if the results of measurements other than M provide no information relevant to predicting the result of M that's not already contained in that state description. In particular, in our example, a state will have remote income outcome independence if the knowledge that you got outcome B in your remote station does not affect the probability of getting A at your immediate station. The value of B gives no extra information. Now notice that any deterministic state description is automatically predictively complete because then by definition alpha, if it is deterministic, alpha is a hidden variable which by itself is going to determine a unit outcome for the measurement. However, the converse is not necessarily the case. That is, a predictively complete description need not necessarily be deterministic. For example, Ballantyne and Jarrett give this example, a particle a single particle of spin a half in the quantum state up. Okay? That does not complete, that's not deterministic, that is, it does not uniquely specify the outcome of a measurement made in a different direction. On the other hand, there is no other information that you could possibly use to narrow that down. So that's a case where you have a predictive completeness but not determinism. We certainly know, this is very well known of course in quantum information, that quantum mechanics does have the non-signaling property, and it's pretty trivial to establish that simply by doing standard manipulations with the density matrix of the system. If the rho LR is the density matrix of the two-particle system and rho R the reduced density matrices of the two subsystems, then this quantity is given by this expression here. So the sum over B of this quantity is given by this expression here. However, the sum over possible projections, that is, over the possible final states of B, is just the unit operator, and so that's just equal to this quantity here. That, in turn, is equal to this, that, and this thus gives you the probability, which now has no reference whatever, either to little b or to the outcome, capital B. So certainly, yeah, quantum mechanics does satisfy the no-signaling condition to our relief. Does quantum mechanics satisfy remote outcome independence? That is, given that I have a particular quantum mechanical state psi and particular settings, little a and little b, is the probability of getting A, given that we got outcome B at the distant station, simply the original probability of getting A? Well, that would require this, let's see what I've done here. So I think we left something out at this point in the view graph. Since the sub-ensemble, I'm not quite sure what I intended to say there. But anyway, so if we, I think there's something missing in this step here, but a sufficient condition for this condition to hold is that rho AB, the combined density matrix, corresponds to a pure product state. In that case, you can just break up the total density matrix into the product here. So when you take this trace here, just make this decomposition, get that. This is then identically equal to this. This is just 1, and you get this, and you finally get the result you want. So, but however, of course, as you everyone knows, the a pure entangled state does not have the property of remote outcome independence. Again, if we have an EPR singlet with B is minus A, then the probability of getting A equals plus 1 without any information on B is a half. However, the probability of getting A if you know that the outcome of B is plus 1 is just 1. So a quantum mechanical pure entangled state doesn't have this, this property. You notice, incidentally, that mixtures, even if they're unentangled, can and usually do fail to satisfy predictive completeness. That is, suppose that I simply had, just to try to put some flesh on that, suppose that I actually had a mixture of a sort of classical-like mixture of states in which the spins were always oriented opposite to one another, but I don't know in which direction they're oriented. Then it's fairly clear that in that situation, if that's all I know, in that situation, knowledge of the outcome on B does determine the outcome on A, so I don't have predictive completeness. However, that's sort of fairly trivial because I can then split up the quantum mechanical density matrix into sub-ensembles, which do have the predictive completeness property. Okay, well, that's really what I wanted to say about what Bell's theorem tells us about the structure of quantum mechanics. And I suspect, as I say, most of you are already pretty familiar with this in perhaps somewhat slightly different language. I'm not sure how much the language, as it were, has evolved in this particular area over the last few years, but hopefully you do recognize most of those statements. Now let's turn to question B. Irrespective of the validity or not of quantum mechanics, what do the EPR Bell type experiments tell us about the nature of the physical world? And for this purpose, let's essentially, we'll come back to the CHSH theory, but in some sense in slightly different, slightly more generic language. Let's define the class of objective local theories rather generally, conjunction of three postulates. The first postulate is Einstein locality, which is close to, but not perhaps completely exactly equivalent to the strong locality I discussed earlier, basically says that events which are space-like separated cannot exert any causal influence on one another. And that is irrespective of their positioning in time, as it were. So it's if they are outside one another's light cones, then they can't exert any causal influence on one another. Second defining assumption is induction. That is, the state of a physical ensemble is determined entirely by its preparation and not by what is going to happen to it in the future. Finally, and in some sense this is perhaps the most interesting ingredient, we can really take one of two tacks. Tack number one is the one which was originally taken in the first discussions of Bell's theorem, including by Bell himself. It's basically microscopic realism. That is, I'm going to say that a particular photon has specific properties independent of whether those properties are measured or not. Now, as Stapp, Eberhard, and others pointed out long ago, in some sense that really isn't terribly satisfactory, because, after all, the whole formalism of quantum mechanics is telling you that so long as you believe that formalism, you are not allowed to assign this kind of property. However, let's try to do something which, at the first sight at least, might be a little more plausible, and certainly is does not depend so obviously or specifically on the specific properties of quantum mechanics. Let's make the hypothesis of macroscopic counterfactual definiteness. That is, the hypothetical results of an experiment which I could have conducted but chose not to can be treated as a fact about the world. Okay, that sounds a bit abstract. I'll come back in a moment and show you how that works out in the context of the specific experimental setup. So let's consider the implementation of these three ingredients of an objective local theory in the real-life experimental setup. Number one is Einstein locality, and what that means is that the results of a measurement on the left-hand side of the laboratory cannot depend either on the choice of setting, that is, if you like, the context, on the right-hand side, or on the result obtained. So that basically unifies context dependence and outcome dependence, so it's essentially equivalent to strong locality, but perhaps formulated in slightly different language here. Postulate number two, the induction, that says that the state of the ensemble of photon pairs is completely specified by the conditions at the source and possibly in the past light cone of the emission event. And in particular, this is crucial, it's got to be independent of which way the photons in question are going to be switched. So 2 is roughly equivalent in my earlier formulation to the setting independence of the state distribution. Just put in rather more general language. What about 3? Well, let's imagine that here's the right-hand end of the lab, as it were. Let's imagine the particular photon, which we may imagine that we've heralded, say, so we know it's there. It's been switched by the random switch into the apparatus which measures A prime, right? Then, one of two things happens, and we know this by, if you like, by direct observation. Either the transmission counter for A prime clicks, in which case we can firmly assign to that particular photon, and this is, if you like, just an operational definition, we can assign A prime equals plus 1, or alternatively, the transmission counter did not click, and if we had a reflection counter, then it did click. And in that case, we assign the value A prime is equal to minus 1. So at this point, we can say, I think reasonably say, without too many headaches, that the value of A prime is a fact about the world. That particular photon did have either a value A prime equals plus 1 or A prime equals minus 1. So far, so good. However, we now say to ourselves, well, this photon could have been switched into counter A, not into counter A prime. Had that happened, then it's fairly obvious that either counter A would have clicked, in which case A is plus 1, or it would not have clicked, in which case A equals minus 1. And the assertion of macroscopic counterfactual definiteness, I'm going to call it MCFD in future, that's the assertion that this unknown and hypothetical macroscopic event can be treated as a fact about the world. Let me emphasize the macroscopic nature here. We're no longer talking explicitly about photons or their properties. We're simply talking about whether a particular bell would have rung or a particular particular light would have flashed. Right? So we're talking about macroscopic events, but macroscopic events which did not actually occur because we set the switch differently. I think it's fairly obvious that if you make the assumption of macroscopic counterfactual definiteness, then in some sense that rather trivially implies by a possible definition, the assumption of microscopic realism, because you simply define a particular photon to have had the relevant value of A according as the counter would have or would not have clicked. Right? However, that's a relatively trivial point. In doing that, you don't have to make any very specific assumptions about the photon itself. It's just a purely operational definition of the value of A, which that photon had. You can be an extreme sort of Bourian and take the view that in some sense the photon really isn't there at all. It's just the photon is just a link between the source and the macroscopic measuring apparatus. But you can still define microscopic realism in that way. So I think in some sense this idea of macroscopic counterfactual definiteness is a more economical way of dealing with the question of microscopic realism. Okay, so those then are your three assumptions, the three ingredients of an objective local theory. One question, though, we probably ought to raise before we go on. I'm coming back. We'll come back to that in a few minutes. What we'll now try to do is to construct a proof of the CHSH theorem from using these three ingredients: Einstein locality, induction, and macroscopic counterfactual definiteness. And in some sense, you'd say this may or may not go somewhat beyond what we did earlier. Let's take a look at it. Step one. Macroscopic counterfactual definiteness implies that for any given photon, the quantities A and A prime do both exist independently of which of those quantities was actually measured. Remember, we've made the assumption that the outcome which would have occurred had we measured A rather than A prime is in some sense a definite fact about the world, and we've simply defined the value of A for that photon by that hypothetical clicking or non-clicking. Similarly, for the partner of that photon, the quantities B and B prime both exist. Second step, by Einstein locality, since the events in question are space-like separated, at least if we've got a decent apparatus they are, then the value of which A has or would have had at the right-hand end is independent of whether it was B or B prime, which was measured in the left-hand end, and a fortiori also of the actual value of B, which was measured at that end. Therefore, for each particular photon pair, these quantities, AB, AB prime, A prime B, and A prime B prime, all exist. With A, now the crucial point here is that A takes the same value in the two combinations, AB and AB prime, etc., etc. Moreover, the possible values of AB, A prime, and B prime are plus or minus one. Okay, next step is trivial. For four quantities, which are well defined and each have the value plus or minus one, you get this this inequality here. I assume you've all done that. If you have any doubts about that, the answer is sort of rather trivial. I mean, there are only, since each quantity out of these four can only take the value plus or minus one, there are only 16 possible combinations. So just write them down. You'll certainly find that's right. So that is not a difficult step. Next step is that since this has to be true for each individual photon pair, then provided the averages are all taken on the same ensemble, E, which you indicate by putting a subscript E on your brackets here, then the ensemble averages have to also satisfy that inequality. However, we're not quite home yet. The reason we're not quite home is that technically the ensembles on which you measure these quantities are not the same. The ensemble of photon pairs on which you measured, say, the product AB are those photons of which you switched photon 1 into counter A and counter 2 into counter B. On the other hand, this average here was measured on the ensemble which is defined by the fact that you still switched one into counter A, but you now switch two into counter B prime. So technically, that's a different ensemble of pairs. However, you now use the principle of induction. The experimental measurements are, of course, taken on the ensemble of pairs emitted by the source. And the fundamental principle of induction is that once I've specified that the pairs have been emitted by the source under appropriate conditions, then it doesn't matter. The state of the ensemble must be independent of what is going to be done to them in the future. So that then is what justifies us in saying that the statistical properties of those that particular sub-ensemble of which one was switched into counter A and two into counter B rather than B prime, those are identical to the statistical properties of the total ensemble. And that's what justifies the final step, which is to identify these ensemble averages with the averages which are actually measured experimentally. So that finally produces then the original CHSH theorem, which, as we know, is violated by the experimental data. Okay. Again, I assume this is something you're probably fairly familiar with. Any questions, comments, objections? Okay, now we I think we can raise a somewhat interesting question. Can we get, we can certainly, I think there's no reasonable doubt that if we define an objective local theory by this conjunction of three assumptions, then we can prove the CHSH theorem. However, a somewhat interesting question is, can we get rid of any of the constitutive assumptions and still derive the CHSH inequality or something similar to it? First question, I'm not taking these in order now. First question is, can we get rid of induction? Apparently we can't. There's a rather simple theorem, which doesn't appear to be all that widely known, actually, but it's sort of rather trivial. Once you allow the choice of state, or the choice of your ensemble, to depend on even one of the two choices, that is, suppose that I, as it were, have a messenger who comes back from measuring station number one and tells me, at the right-hand end of the lab, say, and tells me that, well, for the on the next occasion, I'm actually going to measure A rather than A prime. Question is, can I then devise a objective local theory which will give me agreement with the results of quantum mechanics, with the predictions of quantum mechanics, under that condition? And the answer is certainly yes. Okay. It's a rather simple theorem, and I'm actually going to use it as a problem, so I won't prove it directly. But that's certainly I think right, and not disputed. So induction really is rather central. However, there's a related question, of course, which you might think of, asking. Is induction really an independent assumption? Or is it simply a corollary of Einstein locality? This, I think, is a slightly delicate question. Certainly, in special relativity, induction is not not really an independent assumption, because if event A here can causally influence event B in its future light cone, and event B can then affect event C in its a past light cone, then by putting those two effects together, assuming that you can, then you can get A to directly affect C, even though C may be way outside either the future or the past light cone of A. So in other words, by violating induction in special relativity, you can certainly violate locality. The question is, does that have to be true in a more general theory? Could we imagine a possible theory which is different from special relativity, in which for some obscure reason or other, this kind of what I call a lambda process, this kind of process is actually forbidden. And I think one can, if you think hard about considerations involving irreversibility and so forth, it's not obvious that you can exclude that kind of situation. So I think it probably is at least reasonable, at the present level of discussion at least, to treat induction as a hypothesis independent of locality. But that may be arguable. Okay, so now let's go on to Einstein locality. Yes?
So the point is that if you don't assume induction, you wouldn't violate the CHSH.
You can construct, that's right, you can construct, if you, in other words, if you allow the state of the ensemble to depend on what is going to be measured on it at even one end of the laboratory, you just forget about the other end, then you can explicitly construct. You can actually construct not just an objective local theory, you can construct a local hidden variable theory, which will do that. Okay, Einstein locality, is that necessary to establish CHSH? And, I'm going off on a slight tangent here because this is not, in fact, as we'll see, the most direct way of getting to the conclusion, but maybe have a little historical interest. Let's experiment with trying to relax the condition of Einstein locality. I published this in 2003, though the work was actually done way back earlier than that. Let's make the following assumptions: that the ensemble of photon pairs is a disjoint union of sub-ensembles such that photon R has polarization U and photon L has polarization V. We'll see in a moment what we mean by has polarization. Each of the sub-ensembles possesses a given distribution, rho uv of lambda, of a set of hidden variables lambda, but the detection process is non-local. In other words, the probability of getting A at station right, say, depends non-trivially on the setting B at the opposite end of the lab. What do we mean by has polarization U? Well, we simply mean that that photon is going to satisfy Malus's law in the sense that the expectation value of A is going to be given by an average over the hidden variable distribution of this quantity A, but this has got to come out to the standard Malus's law result here, right? And you notice the important point is that now this is independent of B. So I think it's fairly obvious that this is going to be a non-signaling theory at this level. And so now we define our model in the following way. We say that for a given sub-ensemble, the expectation value This is the expectation value for the actual experimental expectation value. This is going to be simply an average over the different sub-ensembles corresponding to photon polarizations U and V of the expectation value there. The expectation value of A as the product AB is given by this expression here. And now this may not be, the point is now, this may not be trivially simply a product of the expectation value of A and the expectation value of B. We can, in principle, fix up our hidden variables so that that's not the case. And these distributions satisfy the usual conditions. They're normalized and positive. And finally, we have, as I say, these Malus's law constraints. Even the individual sub-ensembles in this case don't violate the non-signaling condition. That is, even if you knew what U was, you would not be able to infer anything about the setting at the other end from the value of A. So the model is non-signaling, though, of course, the sub-sub-ensembles corresponding to given hidden variables, they would violate the non-signaling condition. In general, it does violate outcome independence and therefore strong locality. Effectively, this what this model is a mixture of different quantum states in which the photons have different polarization. Since it is a mixture, it can violate outcome independence and hence strong non-locality. So it may or may not violate the original CHSH inequality. Now, as we'll see, that's not the whole story, but when I originally did this work, way back in 1976, I think, the only thing that was around was the original CHSH inequality, and I was able to construct an explicit form of this hidden variable theory, which did violate it. It can do it either way. It can either be violated or be satisfied, but as we'll see, that's not the whole story. Well, one can raise the question, are the predictions of this crypto non-local hidden variable theory consistent with those of quantum mechanics? And here I'm just, I'm not going to go through the whole messy story, but simply assume, for the sake of the demonstration, that my photons are linearly polarized, which makes it much simpler. And then there's a rather straightforward argument one can give. Let's consider the case B equals A, where the quantum mechanical expectation of AB is certainly plus one. That means that we also require that expectation value to be plus one in, or we would require it to be plus one in a crypto non-local hidden variable theory. Since the maximum possible value of this product is plus one, this has to be, so the maximum possible value of AB for the sub-ensembles has to be plus one. And since I've got to get plus one for the actual experimental outcome, that must be obtained for all my UV for which this function, this distribution, is non-zero. However, that's only possible if for each lambda with non-zero weight, A of little a and lambda is B. In other words, if I get perfect correlation for each value of the hidden variable. If that's true, then the average of these over lambda must also be equal. In other words, I must get this result here. In other words, the only possible pairs of photons which can be included are now those in which U is equal to V, or equivalently U is minus V, but for photons that's an equivalent state. So we don't have to discuss that separately. Moreover, since you want your predictions to be rotation invariant, as the quantum mechanical ones are, then the expectation value of AB has to be rotation invariant, so F of U has to be constant. So in other words, we can now say that the experimental expectation value in our crypto non-local theory has to be given by this expression here. However, there's a very simple inequality you can prove. For any pair of variables, which are plus or minus one, this expectation value is less than this. We know what these are because we require Malus's law, so we get that. And so finally, the expectation value of AB in this crypto non-local theory is given by this expression here. And you can work this out, and there may possibly be a factor, a numerical factor wrong here, but what is immediately clear is that since you have an isotropic average over the photon polarizations U, for most of the values of U, this quantity is going to be of the order not of A minus B squared, but of A minus B, modulus A minus B. So that has to come out, and it's just a question of whether the numerical factor is right. I think it is, but I wouldn't stake my life on it, because I did this in a hurry. And that's in clear contradiction to the quantum mechanical predictions for small A minus B, which are, as you know, something like this here. So if you require agreement, perfect agreement with quantum mechanics, for all possible settings, then certainly the crypto non-local theory is a dead duck. It's not going to work. If you want now, along the philosophy of CHSH, it's nice to actually try to derive inequalities which are obeyed by the experimentally observed quantities without assuming perfect correlation, anti-correlation. And I did this in this paper in 2003. And you get, for example, this result here, which again turns out to be, first of all, it's inconsistent with the quantum mechanical results, and since then a couple of experiments have been done, and it's certainly violated by the experiments. So certainly it's not a viable theory, as indeed one sort of rather expected. However, a very important observation, which was made by Kolbeck and Renner in this paper in 2008, that really this rather special crypto-non-local theory is a special case of a subclass of a special case of a much more general class of theories, where you have a non-trivial local part, and they demonstrate that no such theory can ever reproduce the predictions of quantum mechanics. And since Roger is here, I've asked him, and he's agreed to just say a few words about that. Thanks. Yeah.
Yeah, so the observation or the sort of idea is to try to extend the conclusion of this model to make it more, or to not use this kind of very specific form of hidden variable model. So in a standard Bell experiment, we have a source and it's distributing kind of photons or particles to these two detectors, and the model that has been considered as explained here, there are some kind of hidden vectors that are attached to these particles, and what locally the detector does somehow is use, and the detector has its own input, which is some angle, and its outputs kind of, or the expectation value of its output depends on these vectors, and actually they're in a product. But you could say, well, let's just ignore the fact that these are vectors, and we'll just allow there to be some anymore. We'll just allow anything to sort of come here. It doesn't necessarily have to be a vector, and we'll just allow any kind of function of the, which depends on the setting here, to be kind of the local expectation value. So, but now actually we'd say that the question, maybe even more generally, so you could just ask, well, could there be any additional information about the outcome? So let's just say we have some setting A and we have some outcome, so call it big A. And now you could just ask, so now you've got the quantum predictions of some singlet correlations. And you could just ask the question, is there any extra information in a theory which could help you predict A? Okay, so as a very general kind of form, this additional information could also be a system which this is some hidden system. And what we kind of want, the question we ask is that, can C give information about A? Okay, so a local hidden variable is a specific case of this, where there's no additional input here, there's just some classical information C floating around. But the more general question, I mean, you could even make this, for example, a quantum, could there be a hidden quantum system? Could take that form. And anyway, so the answer will be no. And so maybe I should just quickly explain this more general Bell inequality that we use. So the idea is, first of all, I should just maybe clearly say what assumptions we used. So the assumptions, and there's actually only one assumption, which is free choice of settings. So this is what, it's just that the setting is independent of the source somehow. So what that means is that when I can pick A to be independent of parameters outside its future length. So anyway, so that's kind of the assumption. And then, so then we use the chained Bell inequality to prove that. And it's just an extension, actually, of the CHSH inequality. It has the advantage that the quantum mechanical value that you can attain in this, the quantum mechanical violation is equal to the non-signal violation. So let me just quickly explain what the inequality is. So we care about, so it's characterized by n, which is a number of the number of settings here of A. Okay, and for convenience we just label these with even numbers and these ones with, and the ones on the other detector with odd numbers. Okay, and we care about IN, which is the probability of the outcomes being equal given A is 0, B is 2A minus 1, plus sum the outcomes not being equal given A, B, neighborhood. Okay, so what we're going to actually do is take our source, we're going to send photons to each. On each side we're going to randomly choose, or on Alice's side we're going to randomly choose one of these measurements, on Bob's side we're going to randomly choose one of these measurements. And then at the end we're going to take our statistics and compute this quantity.
Yes. Can you use a different marker?
Is that better?
Yeah.
Which bit can you read?
It's...
So I write this?
Yeah.
Okay, so now I'm clear.
There's a plus right above the sum, right?
Sorry, this is a plus.
Yeah, right.
So, if I just... Maybe I'll just go over here. So, one way we can just express this relation is as follows. A, B, and goes down like this. Okay, so here's one way I can sort of pictorially draw the quantities we care about in this. This inequality, and wherever I've drawn a solid line, we want the values to be not equal. And wherever I've drawn a, well, there's just this one dashed line here where I want the values to be equal. Okay, and turns out that a classical thing has IN bigger than 1. And you can sort of see that if you imagine trying to minimize this quantity by putting in fixed values of capital A and capital B. Example, if I start here and put in zeros, in order to make this probability of not equal as small as possible, I kind of want to put a zero here. To make this one, I want to put a zero here, I go all the way down. And at the end, I want to put a zero here to make this one small, but I want to put a one here to make this one, small. So actually I get this. Now, quantum mechanically, I can get IN goes like 1 over N. Okay? So, anyway, it's not, maybe it's not so important, but the fact is that in the limit as N tends to infinity, so I can take an infinitely large number of settings for each party, I can get this going arbitrarily close to 0. Okay, so now I should just quickly say what the thing we care about is. So the quantity we care about is how much information C tells us about the outcome of the measurement. So this quantity given So I want C to tell me something about little a, and potentially I could use information about what measurement was chosen and forms, not, and according to, so, and according to quantum mechanics, well, okay, so, if this is equal to this, sorry, I've confused myself because I've tried to adapt the notation. So I want the probability that the outcome given the inputs, right, so this is how much information C can tell me, right, this, so I want this extra system, I'm trying to ask whether this extra system can tell me something about this outcome A here. Okay, so given the extra system, and I could potentially also know this outcome A here, but if that's the same as P of C given C, then it's telling me nothing.
Right, that's what I want to say.
Okay, so, and actually, there's a theorem, which I'm not going to show how to prove, which says that the distance between these two distributions is bounded by IN. Okay. So in particular, in the limit as n tends to infinity, quantum mechanics predicts that there's no actual extra way to tell anything about any extra information about the outcomes at all. So what Bell essentially looks at, maybe I should just quickly contrast that with Bell. Bell essentially says, could it be that P, well, Bell wants that there's some C which tells me everything about the outcomes. Okay, now in this new model, we allow this extra information just to help me predict the outcomes a little bit better. So one example of this extra information could be that, let's say if C is zero, okay, let's say we have a quantum experiment which says that P of A equals zero, P of A equals zero is a half. And now we could ask, and an example of this extra theory would just be, well, there's some C, and when C is zero, we actually have P of A is zero, given C is zero, is say 3/4. So Bell asked the question where, given this extra information, this would have to be 1, essentially. So we can ask whether any extra information, but this would just tell us some extra but probabilistic information about the outcomes. So the question remains, so up to now what we've sort of seen is that quantum theory tells us that there exist correlations which cannot be predicted better. Okay, and that was assuming free choice of measurement. And now the question remains, how to verify that, or sort of whether we can experimentally verify that. And it turns out these correlations are not that straightforward to experimentally verify, and I'm just give a very quick explanation why. So if you have, so we're trying to prove, we're trying to find these, to verify these quantum correlations which have very small value of IN, and if we have some error in our experiment, which are characterized by the visibility, okay, so there's a visibility of 1 and here's kind of 0.9, then actually the curve of achievable IN looks something like this. Okay, so what we want to show is that, so this is 0, we want to show that very, very small values of IN, this value here is about 0.6 or something. So if you have a perfect I2 experiment, so I should have said that I2 is actually equivalent to CHSH. So if you have a perfect I2 experiment, you actually have a value here. So it's like something like 0.57. Okay. Okay, and now as you, I mean, the point with why it's so hard to test this is that in order to get this very low, you actually need extremely large visibilities. Okay, so any actual experiment you do, I mean, we can expect experiments which get further and further out here with time, but they actually have to, they're never going to, of course, achieve this being zero. And so, but in principle, though the theory predicts this, we're never going to be able to verify it's zero, but we can expect a kind of sequence of experiments which, as they improve, take us closer and closer to this limit. Okay, and there's just one other thing that I wanted to mention, which is that I said it was based on this free choice assumption. Actually, we can show that you can weaken this free choice assumption a tiny amount. So, although you would probably imagine if you have a source here and your detectors here, it's kind of reasonable to assume that I can choose something pretty close to independently here. But of course, these systems probably have interacted somewhere in their causal past, and it's very easy to believe that there's a tiny bit of dependence in them. So actually, yeah, this is just a remark that recently been able to show that you can actually drop the assumption that they're completely independent. So you can allow for very, very, well, you can allow for reasonably small correlations between them, but of course not perfect correlations. Okay, so yeah, maybe that's what I wanted to say. Are there any questions?
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. So I think, crudely speaking, from this discussion, one can say that the answer is that yes, in some sense you can, in the sense that Roger has explained, you can prove the inconsistency of your theory with quantum mechanics without invoking Einstein locality, unless you're prepared to relax it completely. So that's a slightly odd state of affairs, but that does seem to be what comes out. The final thing I wanted to briefly talk about was, do we need to invoke macroscopic counterfactual definiteness? Could we get away without invoking that? And that, I think, is a rather tricky question. There's a rather nice provocative preprint, I think it's not published, by Nicolas Gissin, whose title is, quote, non-realism, deep thought or soft option. And what, in effect, he's doing there is to claim that you don't need any kind of realism, or he doesn't mention it explicitly, but one could equally well say one doesn't need any kind of macroscopic counterfactual definiteness in order to prove the CHSH theorem. And that's an interesting claim, I think. And I think, to some extent, it's a matter of definition. Gissin claims to derive CHSH from Einstein locality and induction alone. However, he does need to introduce this quantity, my notation here, PAB, AB lambda, and he needs to make the Einstein locality assumption of factorization in this way. Now, we haven't said at this stage, you see, what lambda is. It's just some kind of, I should probably have written it as alpha in consistency with my previous notation. Lambda could be simply the quantum mechanical state. It could be a hidden variable. It could be something other than either. The real question is, if you don't implicitly, at least, make the assumption of macroscopic counterfactual definiteness or something equivalent, does this quantity actually exist? Now, this, I think, is a quite amusing question and does, I think, test one's basic notions about the concept of probability somewhat. For any one pair of photons, of course, the quantities A and B are not necessarily measured. However, suppose that the hidden variable lambda were to take only a large but finite number of discrete values. Then, assume that we do an experiment in which we have n sub gamma photon pairs such that n sub gamma is much larger than 4 times n sub lambda, much larger than n lambda would do. Then, you see, we can be sure that a large number of pairs with any given value of lambda, of lambda i, call that n sub I, there'll be a large number of those, and that approximately a quarter of them will actually have been subjected to measurement of A and B. So we can define what you might call a pseudo-experimental probability, which is given by choosing a particular value of lambda A and imagining that we had made a large number of measurements with that particular value of lambda, and then define the expectation value of AB as the sum over those experiments divided by the total number. Now, this is slightly odd. You're now taking the sum here over those pairs of photons which, first of all, had the particular value of lambda you're interested in, because you don't know which those photon pairs were, but you can still conceptually define it. Secondly, they should have been subjected to this specific pair of measurements, A and B. So it's tempting to identify this quantity with the quantity which occurs in Gisan's argument here, with this pseudo-experimental value, which only relies on measurements which were actually carried out. So for the quantum state, I should say that's trivial, because for the quantum state, you have a large number of measurements on the same state, the same value of psi. And so you can certainly, in some sense, you can verify this this assumption directly for experiment in that case. Can you do this in the hidden variable case? Well, first of all, I think there are two difficulties here. First of all, you have to assume that this probability here is the same for the hypothetical outcomes in experiments which are not carried out. And the question is that assumption essentially just equivalent to the assumption of induction or not? I think it probably is, but it's not entirely obvious. But in any case, you have to remember there are going to be two limits. If you take the limit in such a way that you allow the number of different hidden variables to go to infinity and the number of photon pairs to go to infinity, but the number of photon pairs is always bigger, much bigger than the number of hidden variables, that's fine. You could get away with this. On the other hand, for the opposite order of the limits, that is, when I take the limit such that n lambda over n gamma goes to infinity, then you have no pseudo-experimental value of this. The point is simply there, that there are going to be plenty of values of lambda for which you never made a measurement at all, let alone a measurement of these two quantities. So under those conditions, it seems you can't really define a pseudo-experimental value of this quantity. And so in particular, this would appear not to work. This notion would appear not to work if lambda is a continuous variable, because then you would need an infinite number of experiments to pin this down. So I think my tentative conclusion would be that, and I haven't, I don't know if anyone's seen this particular question discussed or not. I haven't seen it discussed anywhere. But I think my tentative conclusion would be that if you want to prove CHSH for the most generic possible type of theory, you do need something like macroscopic counterfactual definiteness or equivalent microscopic realism. But, as I say, that seems to me still very much a debatable question. I'm thinking of possibly writing this argument up and sending it to Nicolas and seeing what he thinks about it. Anyway, so basically that's what I wanted to say about the Bell EPR question as such. I realise that there's an awful lot of material which probably some of you are familiar with that I haven't talked about, but I think as regards, in some sense, what it tells you about the structure of the world, this is where we got to. And so now the question is, if it's true that you have to throw away at least one of these three assumptions, which are you going to throw away? None of us really want to throw away Einstein locality, because after all, that does seem to be a very intrinsic part of hidden variable, of special relativity. And it's, you know, somehow one feels in one's guts that things are going to crumble, rather, if one throws that away. It's interesting, incidentally, that the you know, by now there are lots of lots and lots of semi-popular texts on EPR Bill. There must be several dozen, I think, by now. Some of them are written by professional physicists, and some of them are written by popular science writers. When it comes to this point, the popular science writers almost always throw away locality. They say, this shows us that quantum mechanics is intrinsically non-local, and that's a very mysterious fact about the world. Most professional physicists, I think, tend not to. They prefer to throw away macroscopic counterfactual definiteness. And there's a very nice little paper, a very short paper, by Asher Perez, which is actually entitled Unperformed Experiments Have No Results. What I think most people haven't thought seriously about, with a few exceptions, most people interested in this question haven't thought seriously about the question of throwing away induction. And it seems to me that it's entirely possible, and I would say even probable, that if indeed there we do eventually get some kind of new theory of the world which totally supplants quantum mechanics, then quite important part of that theory is going to have to do with a revision of our ideas about induction, the idea that our sort of intrinsic natural assumption that the past causes the present and the present causes the future and not vice versa. But, you know, obviously one can make all sorts of vague words about this. To actually formulate a concrete, any kind of useful concrete theory along those lines, it appears to be incredibly difficult, and I certainly haven't been able to do so, and I don't think anyone really has right now. But as I say, I would strongly suspect that if a major revolution comes in this area, then it will have something to do with the assumption of induction. Okay, so yeah, so I'm through. Yeah.
So are there any other consequences about throwing away any of the three?
Oh, very well. That's the interesting question, I think. Of course, if you're going to, for example, throw away Einstein locality, then an important question is exactly how do you throw it away. For example, do you allow superliminal signaling or not? There are ways of throwing it away which would allow superliminal signaling, and that would have presumably experimental consequences. Throwing away macroscopic counterfactual definiteness seems to me actually a rather uncomfortable idea. Whether it would have experimental consequences, I don't know. Whether it would have consequences for a whole lot of social institutions, I think certainly yes, if you really take it seriously. Look, I mean, just think about a typical case, legal case. The accused is accused of pushing his victim down the stairs, and she died. Right. So the prosecuting counsel says, had the accused not pushed his victim down the stairs, she would still be alive today. You know, no jury is ever going to doubt that that's a meaningful statement, right? And yet, if we really take this seriously, I mean, if we don't want away induction, and we don't want to throw away Einstein locality, we're eventually going to have to take this seriously. And this is actually one of the big motivations for what I'm going to be talking about in the next lecture, which is the issue of macroscopic realism and so forth. So throwing away macroscopic realism, depending again on the level at which you throw it away, is going to have consequences. Is throwing away induction going to have consequences? That, I think, seems to me an incredibly slippery question. This whole complex of questions concerning the arrow of time, I mean, it seems to me, in some sense, the most difficult issue in physics. And the reason is that in most other deep questions of physics, concerning, for example, the foundations of quantum mechanics, concerning special relativity or whatever, at least you know what the questions are. You may not know the answers to the questions, but you know what the questions are. In this case, you don't even know what the questions are, really. It really seems to me a very deep puzzle. And as I say, I think that's one of the great unknowns right now.
So those three assumptions are considered as independent.
Well, as I say, we can argue about whether induction, in the frame of a sort of more general theory of the world, whether induction is in fact independent of Einstein locality or not. As I say, within the sort of standard framework of special relativity, the answer is no, because there's nothing in special relativity to prevent A causing B and B causing C in such a way that you get a non-local causal connection between A and C. But in more general classes of theories, I don't see why one, you know, there should not be built-in mechanisms to prevent that. Yeah?
Is there any experimental proposal for testing induction assumption? So to me, it seems that it's possible to test it because whatever the initial condition of preparation is, you have to entangle your system to a measurement device. So you can might not be able to address the initial preparation, like the rate.
So how does that do anything?
So I was wondering if there is any experimental proposal testing to see if induction works.
Well, I think the problem you see here is that, in some sense, the whole way in which we even frame the concept of an experiment relies on the idea that we can prepare the initial conditions appropriately. What exactly, you know, if you're going to throw that assumption away, then what question exactly are you going to ask? That's the, I think, question. That's why I say, I think there is a small group of people who've for years and years been interested in this question of the error of time. I mean, Hugh Price, Costa de Beauregard, Aronoff to some extent, although he tends to be more interested in the formal issues, I think. But as far as I know, no one has actually formulated a proposal for an experiment which a real experimentalist would consider carrying out. So it's a big challenge, I think. Is there anything there, is it, or is the whole thing just smoke and mirrors?